I had a dream a couple of nights ago. I'm going to tell this story. I had a dream. I was in a large community hall. There were tables and chairs and lots of people playing cards. I was playing cards with these people. I don't know who these people were. It's really not important. Well, it was important to them. It's not important to the story. And I need to go to the bathroom in the dream. Not, I'm fine now. And because I'd had that portion of the dream before, I knew that getting to the restrooms in this building was a nightmare. It's like two sub-basements down, and it's dark and kind of scary. And I figured it would be easier if I just went home, because I only live two blocks away from this place. So I'd go home, and then I'd come back and finish playing cards. So I'm walking to my house, apartment, whatever. I don't know what it was, because I never got there. It's a dream. And I passed by this brick building with a marquee, like an old movie theater. And underneath the marquee is a guy with a microphone. He could be wearing a hat, or maybe I'm just overthinking it. So he says into this microphone, well, it's another Thursday, and so that means it's time for the traditional Thursday night service at the Jewish synagogue of Las Vegas. Which was surprising to me, because I didn't know I was in Las Vegas. And he says that, and suddenly this music starts, ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba, and everybody starts coming out of their houses, and there's cars coming up, and everybody's happy. They want to be at this Jewish synagogue of Las Vegas and do whatever it was they'd done on Thursday night. There's Chinese people, there's Italian people, ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba. And coming towards me on the sidewalk are these four black men. And there's a really tall guy, and there's a short, fat guy. There's a wide range of people, and they're all wearing bathrobes. And they're all going, ba-da, 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 ba. This is the brain that the play you're going to see came from. Thank you. And what you're going to see is a concert preview of my play, Tom Waits for No Man. Somebody just got that. Which means that I'm experimenting on you. We're trying this out. We're going to see if the concept works before I start the long and honestly very expensive process of turning it into a full production. So you are our laboratory audience and a vital part of creating a new piece of theater, and I thank you for that. This has been, in the 13 years I've been writing and producing plays here, the most amazing collaborative effort I've ever been involved in. And the people that you'll see on the stage are just astounding. And I hope you like it. I like it. Picture a broken down saloon on a dust-filled road just outside the kind of town you only live in accidentally. Halfway between last call and last chance, where the drink special is whiskey with a whiskey chaser. And if you include the air in the empty spaces, the place is full. If any of the few sad people wilting at the bar had anything better to do, they'd be out there doing it by now. But a couple of folks still check their watches as the band mounts the stage. The name of the singer is Bobby Ace, except it isn't. He thinks singing someone else's songs is an easy gig, except it's not. The doors are still open, and the beer is nearly cold at the Tobacco Roadhouse. And this is Tom Waits for No Man. Ladies and gentlemen, before we bring out our headliner, Bobby Ace. Hold your applause. Here's a little lady who's never been on the Tobacco Roadhouse stage before. So let's hear it for Bobby Jeannette.
Thanks for having me. Rusted brandy in a diamond glass. Everything is made from dreams. Time is made from honey, slow and sweet. Only the fools know what it means. Temptation. Temptation. Temptation, I can't resist. Well, I know that he is made of smoke, but I've lost my way. He knows that I am broke, but I must pay. Temptation, temptation, I can't resist. Dutch pink and Italian blue, he is there waiting for you. My will has disappeared. Now confusion is oh so clear. Temptation. 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 I can't resist. Rusted brandy in a diamond glass. Everything is made from dreams. Time is made from honey, slow and sweet. Only the fools know what it means. Temptation. Temptation.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, the act all five of you have been waiting for is finally in the building. We've heard a lot about him, but we decided to book him anyway. He's just off the road from somewhere. So here he is, Bobby Ace.
Thank you.
With a little drop of poison, nobody knows they're lining up to go insane. I'm all alone. I smoke my friends down to the filter, but I feel much better after it rains. She left in the fall. That's a picture on the wall. She's always had that little drop of poison. Did the devil make the world when God was sleeping? You'll never get a wish from a bone. Another long goodbye and 100 sailors. That deep blue sky is my home. And she left in the fall. That's her picture on the wall. She's always had that little drop of poison. Well, the rat always knows when he's in with weasels. You lose a little every day. Well, I remember when a million was a million.
I was in a bar once. hard to imagine, I guess, me in a bar. And I meet this girl. We stand there, herself, myself, as the Irish say, drinks in our hands, exchanging witty repartee and pheromones. I don't know how old she is, because that would mean I'd have to consider how old I am, and nothing puts a damper on romance quite like math. But she's wearing the bright yellow sunglasses of happy innocence that I left on a bus to Toledo a very long time ago. And it's kind of breaking my mood. I mean, I usually go for the dark, sullen type who considers depression and leather requirements for a well-rounded personality. So she says to me, "Did you always want to be a musician?" And I says to her, "I never wanted to be a musician at all. I just couldn't hold down any other job. Let's be honest about that." So, I mean, I've been on the road a lot of years, and I wasn't always the dashing free spirit you see before you. Once I had a house and a family and an Irish setter. That's actually a lie. I don't know why I said that. I never had any of those things. You, sir, You have a job. Yeah. You may have a job. Yeah. You have a job? Sitting there at your desk, right? Your office every day with your grande mocha latte and your staff meetings and your cell phone. Well, this is my office. And this is my staff. And have you seen my cell phone? Seriously. Have you seen my cell phone? I have no idea. Is that mine? No, I don't think so either. Bobby over there said, just off the road. The thing is, you're never off the road. The road is always there. You know, the road goes ever on, one beer-soaked place after another. And it's not like these palaces of musical splendor are neatly strung across this fair land. I get a gig. A gig, my friends, is what we call a one-night show, and you can throw that into your next conversation at the cappuccino machine. A gig is a fork you use to spear frogs and suspend them into the air until they make vaguely musical noises. I get a gig in Santa Cruz on Friday, San Antonio on Saturday, San Augustine on Sunday. And how do we manage to make this pilgrimage all the way across the country on this saintly trail from California to Florida in 3 days? We don't. It's impossible. And that's how we ended up here. To be honest, I don't even know what town this is. And I bet $100 that they don't know either. This is my band, these guys, the band of Bobbies. I say my band, that's like saying my cat. It's never really yours. It's an uneasy truce based on food and flea removal. But they've been traveling with me for a long time, most of them. Well, I recognize this guy, Bobby the Animal. Thank you. Dr. Bobby over here on the piano, we picked up where, what? Yes, please. We picked up where?
A babka?
The rest of them come and go. Some of them get gigs with other bands. Some of them leave the music biz completely. Where did Trombone Bobby go? And forget about it. He became a large animal vet. Think about that. Instead of playing with me, he'd rather stick his hand up a horse's. Anyway, enough of this dazzling between song banter. Let's go. Eyeball Kid. One, two. What? What did he say? This is the set. This is where we do Eyeball Kid. We always do Eyeball Kid. Now, don't screw with the set, Bobby.
That's not Bobby.
What happened to Long Tall Bobby?
Late, ran away, ran over. I don't know. We got this guy.
All right, so Bogus Bobby. What do you know? It's dreamy weather, we're on you. Wave your crooked wand along an icy pond with a frozen moon. A murder silhouette crows I saw in the tears on my face, in the ice on the pond. Your spell, Alice.
disappear in the name. But you will wait for me somewhere across the sea. There's a wreck of a ship. Your hair is like meadow grass on the tide. And the raindrops on my window. And the ice in my drink. Baby, all I can think of is arithmetic, arithmetic. Turn the hands back on the clock. How does the ocean rock the boat? How does the razor by my throat? The only strings that hold me here are tangled up around me.
actually. Sorry. We don't do that song usually right now. Can I get a drink? What's going on here? Thank you. Oh, so readily accessible.
Who knew?
Almost as if it were planned. There's a set, you see, of songs. It's been carefully constructed over years of top-notch, highly professional performances, just like the one you're enjoying here tonight, over the sounds of breaking glass and dropped dishes. So we can play the songs and I don't have to think about it. It's like Vegas without the showgirls. Everything runs like clockwork. if the clock didn't have hands and maybe a broken spring. Look, Ma, no hands. Actually, I think it's more like stumbling into a crime scene. Like you unlock your front door and everything you own is on the living room floor. You know you've been robbed, but it kind of takes you a while to figure out what they took. That's our show. Something's going on, you feel like you've been ripped off, but you can't decide what's missing. Tip your waitress. So by the looks on your faces, I guess I should explain my thing. I have a thing, everybody has a thing. My thing is we play the music of the great American songwriter, Tom Waits. It's not an impersonation, some sort of Beatlemania, Waitsalmania. I hate that. I'm not doing him. No one is ever gonna put giant letters up on a screen that says Bobby Ace is Tom Waits. No one. Ever. What? I don't know what she's talking about. What do you call it?
That would be an interpretation.
An interpretation. Yeah, it's an interpretation.
An homage.
When I first got on stage, I was a sensitive soul, a folk singer, a freaking troubadour sitting on a stool telling stories about love and depression and some historical anomaly that would have been lost in time if I didn't put words to it and a 4/4 beat. Do you know about Peg Entwistle, who committed suicide by jumping off the Hollywood sign? Didn't think so. Angelo Fatticone, the human cork, the 1919 Boston molasses disaster, important events, and the sap rolled down Atlantic Avenue in a suffering, smothering flypaper goo. Nobody would know about these things if it wasn't for me. Wreck of the Edmund Fitzgerald, my ass, this was damn poetry. I would keep the house lights on so I could look at the beautiful faces of the beautiful girls in the front row and commune with them. After a couple years, all I could see was my mother's face staring out from behind every pair of eyes, expressing her disappointment. So I started joining bands. Everybody's been in bands. You were in a band. Let's see, I can't see. You were in a band. You look like you're still in a band. Am I right? A slight head circle. I'm not sure what that means. But here's the thing, lots of bands. We were all in lots of bands. And the more bands you're in, the more people you surround yourself with, the closer you get to the Mount Olympus of ignominious obscurity. You can't name me one person who's been in lots of bands and is still famous. Nobody. You can't do it. Go ahead. Try.
Clapton.
Shut up. I would come down there right now and throw you out myself if this stage wasn't so high. So lucky for you. You can't do it. I was in lots of bands. The Flying Burrito Brothers. The Holy Modal Rounders, Uriah Heep, great names, great bands. I wasn't in any of those. My bands had names like Iridescent Oil Spill and Mother Brown's Home for Imaginary Children and Scourge, of course, spelled S-K-R-J. Mm-hmm. Horrible. Ill-conceived, cat-yowling music. Bands all stacked up like boxes of half-eaten pizza. There was a line of them from New Jersey to Nevada, each bursting into flame, one after another, like a westward line of warning beacons, saying, "Look upon the approaching death of American music and despair." By the time I got to LA, I was the only one left in the band. I would wake up, get out of my van, and sneak around into the back door of every club that had a back door. And what did I see? Pretty, young, long-haired boys singing about faithless love and following the grape harvest and their dreams of being cowboys, like any of them could ever be cowboys, with their soft little hands and their leave-in conditioner. And each voice was better than the last one. There could be 20 people all singing a different part in perfect harmony, like a new choir of angels had landed in Los Angeles. I was doing a pickup gig, playing with some guys. We were third on the bill for a horrible post-punk piece of crap band from some horrible post-punk piece of crap record label. And I was trying to convince the bartender to spot me another beer when this scruffy guy I never heard before sort of oozed behind the piano in the break. He was not much to look at. Maybe he smelled a little. Although we all know what you're thinking. It was probably me, yes. And he started playing. It sounded like he was hitting the piano keys with his knuckles. And his voice wasn't much. Rough and real and very unpretty. And it was Tom Waits. I sat there and listened to the entire set, not seeing or hearing anything else around me. He sang about misfits and hobos, circus folk and old cars and heartbreak. And when he was done, I couldn't move for a good 10 minutes. And then I thought, hell, I could do that. I knew I couldn't sing like the Pretty Boys and I couldn't write like Waits, but I could do what Waits did. Literally. And so that's what I do. His songs. It really surprises me when people have never heard of him. He's one of those guys who might be more famous for who he is than what he's written. The guy who's been covered by the Eagles with Old 55, Springsteen with Jersey Girl, and Rod Stewart with Downtown Train. Waits is better known for saying, "I'd rather have a bottle in front of me than a frontal lobotomy." And that wasn't even his. So, if you don't know, see, people know it. Whispering about it right now. Someone left a cake out in the rain. Not him. I crawl like a viper through these suburban streets. Also not him. Hit me, baby, one more time. That shouldn't be anybody. What he does write is things like, "'Tain't no sin to take off your skin and dance around in your bones." And "there's always free cheddar in a mousetrap, baby." And "in a land, there's a town. And in that town, there's a house. And in that house, there's a woman. And in that woman, there's a heart I love." Sometimes I play them the way they were written, but sometimes I take Tom's music. I call him Tom. He calls me copyright infringement.
Homage?
Homage. And I mix it up a little, put something fresh on top, keep it interesting. You know how you see a certain car all your life? Take a minivan. People hate minivans, right? Then one day you see a Ford something. I don't even know if Ford makes minivans. Let's say they make a Ford falafel. A Ford falafel drives by and it's this amazing color, this grayish, greenish slate that is the exact color of your first girlfriend's eyes, and suddenly, you love minivans. Songs are like that. You can take a perfectly good song that has a tango beat and play it in bebop, or slow it way down, add some Indian percussion, and it all breaks out of what you expect and becomes altogether different. A switch turns on in another part of your brain, like falling in love. When you go home tonight, put in a song you know real well and clap your hands in a different beat, or dance the waltz to a hip-hop song. It might become that minivan you've waited for all your life. Or it might just be an excuse to dance. Some dance to remember, some dance to forget. Right? Some dance just because they want to dance. Not at that tempo, though. Thank you. Maybe next time you won't be too good to stand up and dance a little bit. I once had a girl, or should I say she once had me, who was a dog sled driver. People actually do that, you know. She had a sort of Asian name, like Jenny Se Kwa. I remember her tattoo Her name escapes me. That was not racist. She'd spend months up in Canada, living with dogs, sleeping with dogs, freezing with dogs. She always had this doggy smell. And a fine layer of moisture on her pale, snow-burned skin. A slight silvery sheen. Very sexy. It was always too warm for her. Right? Yes. So she didn't wear much clothing, unless she was knee-deep in frozen tundra. Her tattoo ran in flowing loops of script from one exquisite shoulder blade to the other. Just thinking about it makes me shiver. It said, "The only kind of love is stone blind love." Tom Waits, see? She was smart. She was funny. She wanted me to get involved in all of her causes, of which there were many. I stayed out real late, slept with other people, and didn't give a damn about much of anything, and wanted to see her naked whenever possible. We were made for each other. She would say to me, "If you're going to be an artist without excuses." And I would say to her, "I am not an artist. I'm a musician. I eat and breathe excuses. There ain't no art to it. You put a hat on the sidewalk and hope you're in a neighborhood where people still carry coins." Thank you. One more glass of wine for this fine lady in row two. She's still going too, which is so great. She said she respected honesty, so I told her if she really wanted me to stop drinking, I'd have a hard time staying warm or awake when she took me out to see her dogs that I hated with a passion. I'm that kind of guy. You want me to be honest? I'll be honest. So after she left, I swear, she left in a dog sled up Massachusetts Avenue in Boston in July. These were tough dogs. After she left, I took myself in hand and went in for retox. The world looks different. She knows what I'm talking about. Yeah. The world looks a little different after 5 or 6 saloons. Fuzzier, unbalanced. And after she left, I decided she was right. I needed to live my life my way. You want me to be a musician? This is how a musician lives. I do not give a damn. Ain't that right, Bobby? Do I give a damn?
No, sir.
That's what I thought. Am I right, Bobby? Do I give a damn?
I'm not Bobby.
Bobby, do I give a damn? Is he still there?
No, sir. You do not give a damn.
Thank you very much. This guy over here who will not talk. I forgot. He's the special one. He's one of those guys. He doesn't curse. He doesn't drink. If he doesn't agree with you, he just says nothing. He's a good guy. He's better than all of us.
You're better than me, aren't you?
Aren't you? Aren't you?
I'd kick him out of the band tomorrow, except he's the only one left with a driver's license.
So I keep him around. He's my no-nonsense, absolutely no fun conscience. You know how they say my conscience bothered me? That's him. He bothers me. I've got a slobbering devil on one shoulder telling me, "Go ahead, do it, do it, do it." And this Buddha on the other, watching everything and shaking his head. Exactly, just like that. Like that's how he communicates. Ladies and gentlemen, a round of applause for Big Buddha Bobby. Yeah. You know, the thing I can't stand most is he's right. He is better than me. He knows it. I know it. All this stuff I've been doing for 10, 20, who the hell knows how many years, it's not music. Noise. It's all noise. It's not music. Yet. Sometimes I try. Sometimes I don't. I just make noise. But I ain't there yet. It's not music yet. It should be. It deserves to be. Listen to these songs. Arithmetic, arithmetic. He probably thought of that in his sleep. Yeah. I'm letting these guys down, and they don't expect much from me to begin with, so. I give up. That's it. Dr. Bobby, you want the band? You've always wanted the band. Don't you lie to me. I see you over there with your fingers. Look, he's like, he's seriously ready. Fine. It's yours. Take it. Take them. Take the guys, the crazy drummer, the audience, this fine, beautiful audience. And the days on the road and the heartache and all the Bobbies in the world. It's yours. I give up.
Break.
Not literally. Stay there. We're gonna play more songs. There are no unions in this band. Any union members in the band in the room tonight? Probably. I asked a real question. No one responded. Okay, I guess not. All amateurs here tonight. Good. I need to be entertained too, right? I had to travel 1,000 miles to get here eventually, and if I'm the sole source of your amusement, we are all deeply screwed. This is like a conversation up here. You and me, except I do all the talking, and you try to drink more than me. I feed off the energy of the audience and all that Stanislavski actor crap. You wanna do that? Let's do that. So I'll sing. This is how the world will be. And you sing. Well, listen to the instructions first. Or it's not gonna work. This is how the world will be. And you sing. Everywhere I go, it rains on me. Let's practice. This is how the world will be. Okay. I'll do that, and then you do that, and then I'll do it, and we'll all do that for a little while. And then we'll have a drink, and you'll go home to your loving families, and I'll get back on the bus, and I don't know what these guys will do. Apparently, I don't know half of them. So let's do this. It'll be fun. This is how the world will be. 40 monkeys drowning in a boiling sea.
Everywhere I go, it rains on me.
I went down to the valley to pray.
Everywhere I go, it rains on me.
I got drunk and I stayed all day.
Everywhere I go,
the chorus, everywhere I go. It rains on me. Oh, God, children, can't you see?
Everywhere I go, it rains on me.
Louis, Lista, and Marquezy.
Everywhere I go, it rains on me.
Robert Sheehan and Paul Bodie.
Everywhere I go, it rains on me.
everybody, everywhere I go. It rains on me everywhere I go, everywhere I go, everywhere I go. It rains on me. Come on, ladies, hit that high note. Give yourselves a hand. I grew up somewhere, flat, Kansas, Texas, the Dakotas, I don't know, I was a kid, I barely know where I am now, why would I know then, what would be the point, I just knew that it was flat. If you stood on the ground, you'd see as far
as the side of a house. And if there was no house, you'd see flat, right? Yes, flatness. There wasn't any way to tell how far away things were. Flying birds were an unsettling surprise. If you saw clouds, you ran the hell away because something biblical was about to happen. It's like at the weird times, you know? There's no perspective from flat land. Your reach is as far as your hands. Like, forget about getting a world view. There's no view at all. My daddy's name was Daddy. Seriously, it's on his birth certificate. Daddy Ace. And no, our last name was not really Ace, but I think we've shared a whole lot of stuff, and that's one vein I'm not opening tonight, so thank you. Imagine what kind of parents would name their only son Daddy, and you have an idea about the gene pool from whence I came. So I had a hard time calling him Daddy. It was like those kids who call their mothers Brenda or Phyllis. And then Phyllis told me to go to my room, the cow. I called him Pop or the old man or mostly nothing at all. He farmed. He had chickens, horses, cattle. We had pigs. We had one pig, a pig, Lucille. We were as poor as dirt, and the dirt was pretty poor. I mean, it gave us nothing. The starving bits of land around us quilted together with wooden fences. They had barely enough life in them to hold water, never mind crops. I mean, we'd spend more money on hay for feed and corn for chickens and nipple balm for cows that never gave us a drop of milk than I ever saw go into shoes for us. I don't think I ever had an apple in my hand that I didn't steal from Lucille. My daddy loved that pig. He called her sweet names and massaged her little trotters and rasped her hooves with diamond files so her feet sparkled when she walked through the wallow. But my daddy, what he loved most of all, what grew in his heart, like the corn and wheat he couldn't get from the fields, what took his mind and his time and his attention away from us, was art. I hated his paint-stained fingers and his patchwork kaleidoscope of his jeans and his shoes and the rainbow handprints on Lucille's skin, and I hated his art. He was an artist, and I hated it. He would go to town. Whatever sandblasted town it may have been, and buy rejected cans of paint, some weekend redo project that was ordered cabbage leaf green but mixed up seaweed brown instead. So we got these gallons of firehouse red and blueberry blue and, you know, piss yellow for pennies. And he hauled them up one by one to the roof of the barn. The only canvas big enough to hold his dreams. He created giant murals from one end of the barn to the other, painted with mops and brooms and anything he could find his hands when it got fiddly and detailed. The Taj Mahal one time, then a month later, the starry night, as big as the actual sky. He never saw any of what he painted in real life. He got images from books at the Goodwill, butterflied open on a corner of the barn and blown up as big as his brain. His brain beaten by the sun, hot until he was as mad as Van Gogh. He spent a month painting something by Toulouse-Lautrec and scandalized the entire county with its pink dresses and exposed ankles across the shingles. And understand that unless you were perched in a tree, which we had none of, it was impossible to actually see these paintings unless you were a very long distance away, but outrage has an all-seeing eye. One day, he was painting the Piazza di San Marco, Venice, you all know, with steely blue lagoon and lion banners and water up to your ankles. The movie in his mind showed tourists swarmed by pigeons, sitting on their heads with nervously scarecrowed arms, gondoliers walking across the bridges, heading for a pasta dinner with their wives and fat Italian babies. After a long day pushing Americans through the canals, waiters in long-starched aprons bringing tall glasses of Prosecco to lovers sitting in the open square, he had all this in his head, and what came out the end of his brushes may not have been an exact reproduction, but he never cared if it wasn't perfect. It wasn't an impersonation. It was right enough for him. As he was reaching out to the edge to fill in a last Byzantine cobblestone of St. Mark's Square, his hand slipped on a half-wet patch of romance-colored paint, and he slid off the roof without a sound. While he fell, he probably thought, this is an interesting angle. And he fell, his brush still in his hand, until he stopped. Landing squarely on his beloved Lucille. We had her for dinner for weeks. That's the way he would have wanted it, I think. There are still times when I feel like I hate his paintings. And I hate the painter for letting them kill him. And that day I swore that art would never have a place in my life. And yet, here I am. You might guess that I live with a packed suitcase by the door, always ready for the next gig and the road. Truth is, I don't have a front door, and I don't have a suitcase. I don't have much of anyone except who I'm on stage with. What's left of my family? That's a song of historical tragedy that shouldn't ever be written, trust me. All that I really have to my borrowed and implausible name is this 3 square feet around my shoes, barely enough to turn around. This is my world. It may not spread very far, but it goes up, straight up, past the sky, and it goes straight down through the earth, and it's got me right in the middle. And what world could possibly be better than one with me at its center? And I get to populate it when I can bear it with all the stories in the universe. Like the man said, I got a head full of lightning and a hat full of rain. So she says to me, do you want to be a musician? And I says to her, I never wanted to be a musician at all. It's what I became, you know? It's what I do. It's who I am. It's so hard to dance that way. When it's cold and there's no music. Your hometown, it's so far away, but inside your head, there's a record playing, a song called Hold On.
If you live it up, you won't live it down. So she left my real son, just like a bull that leaves a gun. With her charcoal eyes and her mono hips, she went and took that California trip. Her crooked little heart. St. Louis got the best of me. I miss your broken China voice. How I wish you were still here with me. Oh, you build it up, you can wreck it down. Bogus Bobby.
Down by the riverside motel, it's 10 below and falling. By a 99-cent store, she closed her eyes.
It's so hard to dance that way. When it's cold, there's no music. Well, your old hometown's so far away. But inside your head, there's a record playing, a song called Hold On, Hold On. You gotta hold on. Gotta hold on, take my hand, standing right there. You gotta hold on.
On the drums, Mark Feinman. On bass, Mr. Chuck Archard. Our special guest on tabla, Riad, Abdulsalam. On guitar, Mr. Jeremy Birdsall. The beautiful voice of Lloyd Jeannette. And the amazing saxophone of Mr. Danny Jordan. And someone without whom the show would not exist. I want you to know that he did a matinee this afternoon at Mad Cow before he came here to do this show. He is a talent and an inspiration, Mr. Cole NeSmith.
And of course, Joseph Hayes, our wonderful writer. And the man who makes Orlando better, Benoit Glazer. Yes.
Thank you all for coming.